Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. And I sing because you are good.
Welcome you to First Baptist Church of Pearl City, where you are worshiping with us in person, or if you're joining us online, we welcome you. If you are in person today, we encourage you to sing along with us if you are fully vaccinated and you keep your mask on. Let's just praise the Lord today and be thankful for what He's given us each and every day of our lives.
Thank you.
stronger than the power of the grave. Constant in the trials and the chains. One thing remains. It's higher than the mountains that I face. Stronger than the power of the grave. Constant in the trial and the chain. One thing remains. One thing remains. You laugh when it fails, it never gives up, never runs out on me.
Morning. You know, I'd like to start off this morning just with a few words from, you know, author, pastor, theologian, Robert Charles, or as most people knew him as R.C. Sproul. You know, and R.C. Sproul, he shared these words that I found to be quite profound as in applied to the Christian life. He said this: God doesn't want us to just feel gratitude. But and here he's talking to the Christian. But for us to show it by giving thanks to God with our lives. Let me read that first again. You know, God doesn't want us to just feel gratitude, but for us to show it by giving thanks to God with our lives. You know, I really like these words because they sort of kind of throw out this goal for each believer to follow. You know, I really don't think it's, you know, I do think it's important to give thanks through our words, but to do so through our actions, well, to me, that speaks the loudest, you know. And so this morning, I'd like to spend our time together exploring this, you know, this idea, and perhaps through some helpful practices that may lead us on the path of living, you know, not, you know, just speaking, but living a life of thanksgiving. And so as we dive right in, if our desire is to do this, I want us to take a look at Psalm 100. And I believe there we'll find some helpful practices that we might be able to implement in our lives. And so let's start off with something simple. And the first, you know, application or teaching point is this: give a shout out. You know, what I mean by this is try waking up each morning giving a shout-out to the Lord. It sounds kind of weird, maybe a little bit cheesy, I think, at times. But I read this article that, this practice can actually boost happiness in the morning. You know, as well as it can kind of provide this positive outlook for the day ahead. And so there are some definite benefits, you know, to us personally, but it goes beyond that. It allows us to express our gratitude to God. You know, so may we be in the practice of sharing with the Lord how grateful we are. You know, a thankful heart, it said, is a happy heart. And perhaps because gratitude, you know, is this powerful thing, you know, it's powerful simply because it's both a feeling and an action. Something we can experience as well as put into practice. You know, listen to verse 1 in Psalm 100. It says this: make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. You know, so when I say wake up each morning to, you know, give a shout out to the Lord, it, you know, this isn't to be mistaken with, you know, perhaps, a, you know, when you get up, I don't know how you guys get up, but some people get up, they're not, you know, in the, you know, sometimes on the wrong side of the bed. I don't know what the wrong side of the bed looks like, but sometimes we get up with a grouchy grunt or a cautious cry, and it's not to be mistaken with that, but more this joyful shout, meaning to be excited. You know, be proud that we have a good God who showers us with mercy, with encouragement, and with love. So be thankful and give a shout out each morning. I believe it'll make a world of difference. You know, another thing we can do is improve our serve. And I guess what I mean by this is that if we want to live a life of thanksgiving, approach each day with the mindset of how we can serve God and others. You know, have we ever done that? You know, do we get up in the morning with this, you know, with this mindset of what we can get out of the day, or do we approach it with the mindset of what we can give, what we can contribute, how our actions can make a difference for others during the day? You know, listen to verse 2. It says this, and I'm reading Psalm 100 out of the New King James Version, but verse 2 says this: serve the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. You know, serving God and others, it isn't hard. You know, and I'll just throw that out there. But it doesn't just happen either. We have to be intentional about it, I believe. You know, if we're at a loss at how to begin, personally, I'd start with prayer. You know, ask God to guide and direct us to areas or to individuals to which we can serve, to how we can serve. There's also, you know, books, you know, or even resources like websites that might even kind of share pointers. I came across this website a while back called randomactsofkindness.org, you know, and I was just looking for different things and just stumbled onto it, and so I started kind of looking into it, and there were all these things on there, right, you know, like just, you know, what they're all about, you know, all these different types of ideas that one could kind of implement the practice of through their lives. You know, they even have a group name because you can kind of sign up and get all these, you know, kind of information and stuff. And this group that are kind of part of it, they have this name and they're called Ractivists, you know, Random Acts of Kindness with Vis, I guess, you know. And at first I thought, man, it's kind of like some kind of polite terrorist group or whatever. But really the organization, their purpose is to make kindness the norm. Not the exception. It has all types of suggestions as to how we can serve others through encouragement and kindness. Now, you know, as I look through that, you know, like I said, you know, I've tried to implement some of these practices, you know, myself, and now they don't always turn out the way that I would have thought they would have. You know, like oftentimes I like to kind of think through the whole process through my head, right? And in my head, things actually work out amazing 100% of the time. You know, but actually as they kind of trickle their way out of my head and through my actions, you know, they don't always pan out the way that I would like them. You know, but I guess it's the thought that counts. And one of those happened this past September when we were dropping off our girls at college. And so, you know, we flew up there, and I knew that I was going to be up there a little bit longer than my wife. And so we, as a family, we flew into Spokane to drop off our younger daughter. And then we kind of split up because then the second part of that, or the, you know, the next part of the leg was our older daughter and myself flying down to Riverside where she's going to school at Cal Baptist. And so throughout this whole thing, you know, I realized that I would be on the mainland longer than I had room in my suitcase, so I'd have to do laundry. And so one of the things on that website was, they had this thing was like, you know, one thing you could do, and so, because I knew I was going to wash clothes, was like, leave extra quarters on these washing machine places, because washing clothes at a laundromat can be expensive, and oftentimes people who use laundromats may be more on a fixed income, all these things, right? So I was like, I can do that. So I packed a roll, a $10 roll of quarters, and you know, I will say this right up front. FYI, they don't really use quarters at laundromats anymore. You know, I showed up with my $10 of quarters. It's automated and all these things. And You know, so I get there, and I have this, and I've been lugging around this $10, of course, in my backpack, which made it a little bit heavier, but, you know, oh well. And so I get there, and I'm like, there are no slots for the quarters, and so I'm like kind of baffled, and so I'm asking all these questions, and like then I find out where you got to go to this one machine where you have to, you know, either insert bills, right, or your credit card to upload, I guess, put all your money on a card. Then it spits out the card, and then now you use the card to pay for whatever machine you're at, if you're at the washer or the dryer, you know. And I'm thinking right now that this is an unnecessary process. I had $10, right? I could have just chunked all those change in there, but obviously, you know, I'm not on the laundromat policy making team, and so I can't give my 2 cents. And so this is kind of the deal where I think that this is one step too much, but you know, but I can still make this work, right? So I figured, well, why don't I just put more money on my card, and then that way I can gift my card to someone else. I can't just leave it now, but I have to, you know. So I do that, and then, you know, proceed to wash clothes, and then, you know, then I got to throw it in the dryer, and now, you know, the dryer, we're on the home stretch, so I'm reading this book, and I'm just actively kind of scoping or surveying the land to figure out who can I give, you know, my card to, you know, that has going to be the remainder of this money on there. And so I identify, you know, a mom and her daughter, and I'm like, okay, yeah, I can do this. This is going to be good. And then so I actually kind of formulate a presentation in my head, because that's, you know, I'm not a wing it kind of person. And so I kind of have the whole speech going on. I'm kind of, you know, I'm looking at the countdown of the dryer, and then I'm like, okay, I got to get this, you know. And so I formulate the speech. I'm good to go. Clothes come out, fold it, put it back in my bags, and now I'm ready to go, right? So I go up there, and this is weird anyway, because, you know, I'm just like, okay, you know, I don't know what people are going to be thinking. I'm not from here, but that's kind of part of the speech. So I just kind of go up there, and I say, hey, you know, hi, blah, blah, blah. You know, I'm really not from around here. I've been washing my clothes. I, you know, I'm not really coming back, but I have this card, and I feel, you know, there's a bunch of money on it, and I just kind of want to gift it to you guys, and just, yeah, you can use it for whatever. Well, you know, and all of that, and they kind of looked at me a little bit strange, but I just thought, like, you know, maybe, you know, just maybe, you know, and I'm not making any presumptions, but maybe, you know, there aren't too many nice people in California, so maybe they're kind of skeptical, you know, and so I'm trying to say this because I want to make myself feel good about myself, so I'm, you know, but they're looking at me, and then they kind of just, you know, okay, and they take it. They're a little bit, you know, kind of looking at me that, you know, some, what's up? But they say thank you, and so I'm good, man. You know, mission accomplished. Grabbed my bags, headed out to the car. You know, and I ain't gonna lie, I felt a little bit good about myself. And I didn't do it just to feel good about myself, but I was feeling pretty good at this point. And I walked to the car, and then I reach out, kind of put my hand to pull out the keys. As I pull out the key to the car, you know, wow, this amazing thing happened. The laundromat card popped out with it. And I'm thinking to myself, man, I got to pick it up. I'm looking at it, and I'm thinking to myself, you know, I don't remember doing 2 laundromat cards, you know. And so I kind of pat down all over the place, you know, like, do I have everything, you know? And then it dawns on me why they were giving me these strange looks, because I realized that the only thing that was not in my possession was my hotel room card key. You know, with hindsight, I thought about it. That was a little weird, you know, like, but I just, it just dawned on me, like, I need the room key back, you know, because the laundromat key ain't going to get me into the room. You know, I make my way back there, and then I am, like, just kind of, like, red. I'm apologetic, and, you know, the mom wasn't speaking as much. Her English wasn't as good as her daughter's, and so her daughter did most of the speaking. Her daughter looked like she was a teenager, you know. And I said, you know, I'm super sorry, you know, like, but I'm going to need that card back. And she's like, oh. I said, because, you know, I meant to give you this laundromat card, and I think I might have gave you my hotel room card, but I kind of need that card back, but I can give you this card. You know, I'm going through the kind of fumbling over the whole thing, and then she just smiles, and she looks at me. Yeah, we were kind of wondering why you were giving us that card, but we just thought we'd just take it. You know, and I was like, you know, I'm super sorry. You know, like, yeah, you know, but here it is, and, you know, right on, have a amazing day. And as I'm walking out of there, I'm thinking to myself, man, I am so glad I'm not coming back to this laundromat ever again, right? You know, but I share that story, and it's not because, okay, you know, wow, you know, look at me, I was this amazing, nice person, or I felt good about myself. But I share it because it wasn't hard to do, you know? It really wasn't. I mean, it didn't go the way that I had planned it to go, granted. But it wasn't hard to do, to wake up that morning with this intention of how can I serve someone? How can I make this day better for someone else? And you see, in serving others, at least for me on that day, it allowed me to be thankful. You know, it allowed me to be thankful that God does provide. And He allowed me to play a part in that provision to others. You know, He had provided for me that I could actually go and do this. We could actually go up and take our kids to school. But He allowed me to be able to play a part in that provision for others. You know, that second go-around, they looked real happy. The first time I handed them the card, they didn't look happy at all. The second time, you know, there was a sense of like, wow, okay, you know. You know, thank you, Jesus. You know, if we want to live a life of thanksgiving, one of the things we can do is improve our approach to serving. You know, another thing Psalm 100 kind of instructs us to do is believe. You know, let's take a look at verse 3. It says, "Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who has made us and not we ourselves. We are the people and the sheep of His pasture." You know, let me start by saying that believing and knowing are similar, but yet they're different. Knowing requires knowledge, while believing requires trust. Now, with that said, when we look at these first seven words here in verse 3, you know that the Lord, He is God. You know, the psalmist, you know, the intent here is that there's this certainty. He's saying, be sure of this. If you were on the fence, you know, before, well, now you need to know. And what you need to know is that the Lord, He is God. We need to understand that we possess knowledge of this. It's in His Word. So understand this. Recognize this as a certainty. Trust it. You know, here's the deal with this. You know, in order for this to happen, to know that the Lord, that He's God. You know, the same Lord, the same God that we witness the works of His hands. You know, we see those works. We see His people. But we don't often see Him. So in order for us to understand this, we need to believe. This one word, believe, it appears to be extremely simplistic. Believe. You know? And most of us, we use this word believe, you know, and it's easy to use, it's easy to say when we're on the peripheral. But when we find ourselves in the center, sometimes it's an extremely hard practice or concept to grasp. And so here it says, know that the Lord, He is God. You know, it's saying believe. We need to, you know, we need to believe that we are His creation. We need to believe that we are His people. We need to believe that He, the Lord, He is God. He is our God. He is our Lord. But it starts when we believe. Finally, we can sing a song. You know, in 1973, the Carpenters, if you are old enough, will remember this group. They didn't have a long run. It was a short run. You know, it's a brother and sister duo, and the sister, Carrie Carpenter, passed away, you know, at an early age. But during their short tenure, they had these hits of very simple but songs that were easy to sing along to, you know, and it had this amazing message. And so in 1973, they released their hit song, this song called Sing, you know, and it went as high as number 3 on the Billboard Hot 100. And the fun fact is that, you know, the song was actually released 2 years earlier and was written and performed for, you know, as a song that would be sung on Sesame Street. You know, it didn't really go that far. It hit the Sesame Street crowd, and that was about it. 2 years later, the Carpenters re-released it, and it became this amazing hit for them. And the reason I say this is because this song, as simple as it is, it speaks of how singing, how it can transform the way we feel, you know. And you know, listen to some of the words. I think they may even have the song back there. Do we have it? You know, and so they'll, rather than me sing it, you can listen.
Sing a song. Sing out loud. Sing out strong. Sing of good things, not bad. Sing. Not sad. Sing a song. Make it simple to last your whole life long. Don't worry that it's not good enough for anyone else to hear. Just sing a song.
So I'm sure most of you maybe have heard that before. You know, first service, they didn't get the luxury of hearing the music being played. They had to listen to me, you know, and I didn't sing it. I just recited it, you know. But again, you know, when we begin the day, you know, sing a song. You know, be excited about what we're singing about and who it is we're singing to. For the Christian, it's a call to sing of things that bring honor to God, that bring Him joy. Things to rejoice about rather than to mourn. You know, we don't have to overcomplicate things, because a song we sing, it ought to simply be accompanied by the many actions of the lives we choose to live. And it doesn't matter what others may think. And for those of us who don't sing well, that's a good thing. But it doesn't matter. It only ought to matter to the one to whom we sing. You know, so begin each day singing a song to the Lord. You know, and that's what, you know, we see in verse 4. It says, enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. You know, here, I believe, you know, the verse is saying that if we know the Lord, then remember and recognize what he's done and continues to do in and through our lives. Be thankful to him, as the psalm says, bless his name. And now the reason I said sing a song, because that's what's, I believe, actually going on here. You know, this here is an invitation to worship. Invitation, you know, to the worship of God. You know, enter into his gates is really referring to the gates that led to the temple area. And it's similar to those gates out there that lead to this sanctuary. And it's through those gates, right, that worshipers, those who are expecting to come to encounter, you know, to worship God, it's through those gates that those worshipers enter into. You see, there's no other route into the temple but through those gates. And what they find on the other side, they come with this expectation to participate in this corporate public worship, which oftentimes is demonstrated through song. You know, but know that this singing, it doesn't begin in the temple, just as it shouldn't begin only in church. Nor does it end there. Singing a song to God is preparing our hearts to be in his presence. And it involves being thankful. You know, thankful for all that he's done that allows us to be there with him. Now that, I believe, is praiseworthy. It's song worthy. You know, so if we desire to live a life of thanksgiving, perhaps we might begin each day singing a song. You know, these are just a few things that may help us as we try to live a life of thanksgiving. And the key word here is help. You see, this isn't the secret sauce, and if we want to know that, I think we just look a verse ahead, and it won't be on the screen, but there's a fifth verse in Psalm 100, and verse 5 says this, "For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations." Understanding this, recognizing it in our lives, and being grateful for it, it is the foundation on which a life of thanksgiving is birthed. You know, understanding that the Lord is good, recognizing his mercy is everlasting, and being grateful that his truth endures to all generations. These are the things on which a life of thanksgiving is truly birthed out of. Let's pray. Our Father, we come this morning again with a heart of thanksgiving. And Lord, we realize that sometimes we take things for granted, and perhaps most times we do. But as we approach this day, Lord, that we have singled out of the year to give thanks, my prayer is that we don't just limit it to Thursday. But Father, that we explore each day with an attitude of thanksgiving, that we wake up each morning, God, preparing to give a shout out to you, exploring ways to improve our serve, that we believe that you are indeed God, that you are the soundtrack of our lives, God. And so, Father, we thank you this day, and we ask that you hear our prayers. For we ask it, God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
we ought to be thankful for God, for what he does, and the thousand names that he is to us, and as we just sang. And we need to continue to sing songs of praise, because he is the great God. He is the great I am.
You give life, you are love.
We are the earth, and we sing his praises. We shout out his praises each and every day. And through our praises, we can be thankful for what God has done for us. During this week, as we prepare our hearts for Thanksgiving, just dig down deep and just be thankful for what God has given you. There's some signs up here that we had our church family members do, and that's what they're thankful for, of what God gave them. So as you go through this week, we hope you do the same. We hope to see you on Thursday. We will be having a Thanksgiving service at 10 o'clock, and Pastor Keiko will be bringing the message. If you want to come, please register online, or you can still join us online as well. We thank you for worshiping with us today, whether you're here in person or online. And if you're here in person, you are excused, but please be mindful of social distancing as you exit. Thank you.